start again. My name's George Neo, and I'm from Magpie House, and Nino's a therapist at Magpie House in Upway, and he's ready for sessions, private sessions, if you wish. And the theme tonight is Awakening of Humanity. It's a big topic. And on the topic of awakening, how awake are we? I'm actually showing a documentary the following Saturday called Water, the Great Mystery. And isn't it interesting that we know almost nothing about water, and yet we've lived with water for who knows how many tens of thousands of years, and we're made of water, perhaps. There's also some good news and some bad news about the topic, and I'm borrowing from Bruce Lipton, who was saying that the Earth is undergoing a pattern of cleansing. All that belonged to the old paradigm will be swept away. Now, that's the bad news, right? It's all going to be swept away. However, there's good news. The Earth is undergoing a pattern of cleansing. All that belonged to the old paradigm will be swept away. Right? So it's up to you to choose whether it's going to be good news or bad news. But there's no doubt that there's some big changes coming. And so it doesn't matter what Nino says tonight, make sure it's good news for you. That's what I was.
Yeah. Thank you.
This could be also for questions later on.
Okay.
Yeah. So a lot of Nino's messages that we've recorded before on DVD, and we've got a bunch of DVDs down the back there. Our other therapist, major therapist, is Dr. Faye Stone, who's a biofeedback practitioner. And, you know, they're both available for therapy sessions. And Dr. Faye Stone works with frequencies rather than substances. Well, that's one of the modalities. And that's perhaps where we're going as a species. We're going to a new mindset that matter has no substance. There's another DVD which we've got for sale back there. And I'm happy to say the Truth Cinema Meetup group is screening this again. This is about the smart meter agenda and also the wireless proliferation that's happening. It's going up exponentially. I'll just give you a quick rundown of the Magpie House website. So these are our therapists. I've got a yoga workshop coming up mid-March. We offer the finest in Hatha yoga. And the hand balances emphasizes lightness of being, experiential lightness of being. Right? So that's what we teach. These are the two movies coming up as well. Well, tomorrow night, actually, we're playing Holographic Disclosure. We've already played 3 or 4 hours worth, but there's another 2 hours tomorrow night if anybody's interested to come up to Upway. But the one next week is Water, the Great Mystery, and the one after that is about the chemtrails agenda. And when we first showed that 2 years ago, we couldn't get anybody to come to the cinema. This is a brand new presentation, and it's hard data, not just politicized science.
On that note, let's please welcome Nino Borsari. This is going to be a very interesting night, I'm sure.
As we have experienced before. I'm a hypnotherapist, so you will have an interesting evening.
Good evening, everyone. My name is...
My name is Nino Borsari. As you heard, I'm a clinical hypnotherapist. Can you hear me clearly?
No, it needs to be loud.
Are you the only one I can't hear? Can you hear me at the back or not?
Yeah.
You can? Okay. I've been practicing clinical hypnosis for about 13 years now. I'm qualified. I'm a member of the Australian Society of Clinical Hypnotherapists. Thank you. I'm also a member of the Newton Institute, which is a US-based institute on the research of what happens to the soul in between lives. I'm certified by both Brian Wise, who's the author of one of the most famous non-fiction books and one of the biggest sellers, Many Lives, Many Masters, and many other books as well. That's by far the most famous, but he's got about seven of them in his repertoire. The first book is really about how, as a conservative psychiatrist working at head of faculty at Miami Hospital and teaching at Columbia and Harvard and other such places, he did not believe in reincarnation or anything like that, coming from a Jewish background as well. Until he had a patient called Catherine, who he writes about in this book, and she has many, she's multiphobic. She can't take tablets amongst some of her phobias, so he cannot treat her with normal psychiatric medication. But he wants to heal her, and he was already showing that it was an old soul. He didn't give up and tried to use talk therapy. He didn't feel he was getting very far, so as he said, a last resort, after more than a year of practice, isn't it interesting that psychiatrists will keep on going with you for a year, and if they don't think they're getting anywhere? I won't go for more than a month or two if I don't think I'm getting anywhere. But he finally started to try hypnosis, which he acknowledged he had hardly ever used. He decided to try hypnosis, and one of her phobias was a fear of loud noises. was a fear of water. She had a great fear of water, and so he decided that under hypnosis he would do something that he'd read about, some hypnotherapist had written a book about, going back to the original sensitizing event. The first time that a phobia was implanted deep into the subconscious, which then eventually goes into the cellular makeup and can be carried forward life after life. And he asked her to go back, without timeline, just go back to where your fear of water first began. And to his stunned amazement, she appeared to be back in some place like Egypt, sounded very Egyptian, and she was a young mother, and she was killed by a flood, a flash flood, and she'd carried forward this fear, and more importantly, her deep despair at not being able to save the lives or lives of her very young children. She felt like she'd failed as a mother as well, and that carried forward. Without getting into it any further, he then was startled. He didn't believe this, but of course you don't stop in the middle of therapy. But he didn't believe that this could possibly be true, but he was even more startled when in the next session next week she walks in and says, "You've done it." "What have I done?" "Well, my fear of water, it's gone." "Thank you, let's keep going." And he was shocked. And he kept on with the hypnosis and found that more often than not, when he was asking the subconscious mind that has stored absolutely everything that you've ever experienced, knows where it's categorized, just like you've forgotten some letter deep in the substructures of your computer, but there is a letter down there that you've lost, you don't know it, but it's there. And it's the same thing with what we carry forward. From a conscious point of view, less than 0.01% of what the brain takes in, we are actively aware of. 99.999% of what goes into the brain, you are not aware that you're taking it in. But I've had people hypnotized, an orphan in particular, who had never ever seen her parents. And like a lot of orphans, she dreamed about knowing them. And under hypnosis, I was able to take her back to her childbirth, and she was able to tell me the time on the clock within 3 minutes of birth, but more importantly, she was able to see the face of her mother. First time in her life, consciously, of course, she had actually seen it, but now she was consciously seeing the face of her mother. It was a very touching and moving moment, as you can imagine. I think I cried too, it was beautiful. This is when I started to realize that the power of the mind, this is one of my first sessions, and I started to realize that what Brian wrote about was amazing. But the biggest thing about this book is that he touches upon the fact that when he's hypnotizing her, she goes into a superconscious state. quite easily. Some go more easily than others, and she was a star pupil. He happened to come across her very quickly, but she was brilliant and was able to start to bring forward messages from extremely old souls, which we call masters. I suggest you read the book if you're interested in this sort of subject, because it's not the same old. There's some fantastic stuff about the point of life, why we reincarnate into this hard dimension. If you've read that letter I gave out before, you'll see I touch upon that. Okay. So this is, anyone not got that page? If you have not got it, then please go to the front desk, and it's a pink sheet of paper, and have a read at it when you think I'm getting really boring.
Okay, he's got a number of other books. That's the first one.
It's a pink sheet.
Next to the front.
You'll see that, now, the other I'm accredited by Brian Weiss. This keeps on dropping, doesn't it?
I'm accredited by Brian Weiss.
The next thing I did was I started doing that practice, and after a couple of years, some of my clients were saying, are you doing Michael Newton's approach? I'd never heard of him. I bought his book, his first book, Journey of Souls. That's the Journey of Souls. And once I started to read, I couldn't put it down. Michael is, for me, and I'm a deep student of philosophy and comparative religions. I also want to stress, before I say any more, that I'm not trying to sell or pretend that this is absolutely true. I consider myself a researcher in a relatively new science, and I'm offering the things that I'm finding in my studio as things that I genuinely believe are happening to my clients. But this is not an exact science, and it's just like the early days of Freud. It's going to go a long, long way, but where we're starting to go is extremely exciting, and I want to share that news with you tonight. So the second fellow that I've read was Michael Newton, PhD. Like Brian, he did not believe in past life regression. He would say, if you go to one of his websites, you'll see him actually say initially, when people would ask, do you do past life regression? No, I don't do that mumbo jumbo, go to the hippies. But like Brian, he discovered that when he started to ask the mind, rather than go back to your childhood or go back to in this lifetime, but just go back to where this fear or this problem initially began, he would find that people would go back sometimes even thousands of years. And again, just like with Brian, he found that it seemed to be very therapeutic, very cathartic, and it's drug-free. In it, he starts in his book here, the first one, he begins to give excerpts from the 7,000 clinical hypnosis sessions that he did over a 35-year personal career. He's the perfect academic. I couldn't do it. I'm not that good. But he used to do the proper tabulating and cross-referencing so that if ever he did his books, he'd be able to find the various subjects. This subject spoke about drowning, that subject, that person. And the books are very well presented, clinically put forward, but also easy to read. And he progresses from subjects such as your death and your departure, gateway to the spirit world, your homecoming back to the spirit world, the displaced souls, those souls that when they leave the body, they're having trouble about whether they should go back or stay with their loved ones. Orientation, when you go back, in few words, when you first get into the railway station of the homecoming, where do you go? Do you go through customs? You go through various things. I liken going back to the spirit world, and I've done this with many thousands of clients now, that just like we might be comfortable with an airport or a railway station that we go through often. If you go through Melbourne's airport often, then you'll know when you're coming in on a plane where is the best line for customs and where the things are. You'll get to quickly know that some of the tourists will be going along slowly. They tend to go to the first ones, where if you go to the left, you may get through, you know, that sort of stuff. And once you get out to the taxi ranks, where it's quicker to get onto your car or catch your cab or whatever it is. So young souls get a bit disoriented. The majority of us are medium-aged souls. We know our way pretty well. But then from time to time, you come across really old souls. I'm going to play a couple of recordings later on from a couple of these old souls. So Michael wrote about dozens and dozens of excerpts of the progression that he found doing what he calls life between life sessions. And he discovered over those many years that he did this work that if he asked many questions, almost micromanaging the ascension part of the post-death experience, that there was a wealth of information that he was able to tabulate. And in these two books, the first one, Journey of Souls, and the second one is Destiny of Souls. Those two books and two of Brian Wise's books are there, so if you want to have a look at them later on at the tea break, please be welcome. Now, if you have that sheet of paper, I'm not going to go too much into Brian's work because past life regression is known, I think, by most of you. And there's something there. Later on, questions are if you want to ask anything, but there's only so much time. But I would like to quickly touch upon the life between life sessions, because to me, Michael and Michael's work is the most important step forward in philosophical study since Plato. Why I say that rather dramatic statement is because, as we know, the Greeks really brought the consideration of what man is, what our position is in the universe, into a serious study. Something that could be honourably looked at, and not just in some arcane school, some esoteric school in Mesopotamia or in Egypt or place like that. They would philosophise relatively out in the open. If you're interested in it, you could participate. Very much like it is now. And he found that there were basically seven or eight steps as the soul goes from immediate death after a lifetime through to rebirth. And you'll see that I've put them down in point form. I'm just going to expand on a couple of them for you, and then we'll go and concentrate on the part that's in the womb. Because I've been focusing a lot on in the womb of this lifetime with a lot of my clients, and I'm getting some fantastic knowledge from that, and I'll play a few of those excerpts thanks to the permission of the client involved. The first step that we do with the life between life, incidentally, this is about a 5 to 7 hour session. It's a very long session. The client must have done at least a few successful past life regressions with me or any of my other colleagues before we will do one of these, because it's very tiring for both. And we certainly don't want failure. So we have to make sure that the client is ready for this. The first thing is we take them back into the womb. As I said, I'll expand upon that in a minute. Then we go from that bridge back to your recent past life, your most recent past life. Reason we go that way is that I've often found that from the womb, I can actually go backwards, and you'll hear people talking about going backwards to just before they came into the fetus. I do a lot of questioning about what the soul knows before it comes into the fetus. But that's sort of going backwards. It's sort of like reading a book from the back. So this way, it makes it a lot more logical sense for the client to go back to their last life, which inevitably we've focused in detail in a previous session. So we're just going back there now as a stepping stone. We don't spend any time there because we've already reviewed it. At when we did their past life, we will have stopped after they get greeted by their loved ones or their guides. And then we go back to the review of that lifetime. What did that life teach you? Where were your successes? Where were your failures? How can you incorporate that knowledge now into your personal life today? Right? There's a lot of growth from that. And sometimes the answers to that question are very profound from that client for themselves, of course. We go to from that point there to actually going back up, the classic going back to the light. And with whom we do that. As I said before, in a railway station that you're comfortable with and you've been through many times, you don't need any escort. But if it's the first time through a particular airport, it's nice if somebody greets you. And that's very much the way it's treated. If you're a relatively young soul, or if you've had a particularly difficult life and you're stressed, Then you'll be met and greeted, usually by your guides, but sometimes also by your loved ones, just to make you feel that you're okay. From that point of view, we go to the crossing over, which, as I said, is that moving back up, and then the reorientation, when you actually get back into the light. I won't go into any of this in any depth, but in Journey of Souls, it'll go into considerable depth, and it's a wonderful experience there. From the going back into the world, we have reorientation. If we've had a hard life, then the first thing that you will be instructed to do is have a healing, to wash off all the legacy of the negative emotions that you've brought from the earth, all the hardships. But if you've had a good life, or alternatively, you're a very old soul and you tend to be able to breeze through life without becoming too attached to the negative things down here, then you can quickly move on to other stages. And you'll hear the third recording, I think, is where we actually hear a client moving in this lifetime. She's just an ordinary suburbanite. But I had recognized through a couple of earlier sessions, this is an old soul. She's a teacher soul. She doesn't know it yet. And sure enough, when she goes back from the reorientation procedure, where sometimes we'll do a healing, sometimes we'll do a debriefing with our guides about what that life was about. And then more often than not, after that, we will go back to our soul group. It'd be like going home to meet our true soul mates. That's always a joyful experience. But a few specialized souls will go immediately back to work. And you'll hear this particular client who does exactly that. She's actually a little surprised herself that when she's going, there's students around me, and she's thinking, I'm one of those students. But she quickly learns that actually these are her students, and they're welcoming her home. There's lots of love. And it's a very lovely experience, and you can see, you'll hear the transformation from the ego-based mind that she goes into this state to, by the end of it, she's become a teacher, and she's really talking with authority about the subject that she touches. We won't go into that in any depth, but I'll just play that to help you to understand that perhaps when we come to the earth, we come with a specific plan. We know that the earth is going to go through a considerable change at the moment. Nobody in this room, if you come to this room, either you were dragged along, but if you came because you thought this would be an interesting subject, then you're probably one of us. And that is that there are light workers down on this earth. I know my role. I know I was told at 13 or 14 what my role was going to be in this lifetime and why. The reason why I'm supposed to be of service is because the earth, when I was 13 or 14, the earth was in the 60s, very Australia. I grew up in Kew. We had 40 pies in Holden. And I was not that inclined towards spiritualism. I was brought up in a Catholic school. I was going to Xavier College, for goodness sake. So talk about brainwashing. But I did actually ask them a lot of questions. If God is so forgiving, why do I have to burn in hell for playing with something? You know, all these sorts of questions, and they didn't answer, and I didn't like it when they say, don't ask such questions. I figured if I can perceive the question, I should be entitled to the answer. And so I rejected that and went in searches all around my world, like life. I've gone to retreats in India. I've done all the classic 60s and 70s backpacking into all the out countries and the like, and sitting at the feet of various gurus and Krishnamurtis and all these sorts of things. And I believe that that my service now is in doing this type of work for a select few people. So if this resonates with you, then what this life between life sessions are about is that after the reorientation, you then meet your masters, the ones who would be like the headmaster or the form master at your school. They may not be involved in your day-by-day teaching, but they are very aware of what you as a soul are doing in the long term, and they're extremely loving, very supportive, completely non-judgmental, and pick you for certain roles on the earth if you want to go that way. I underscore that freedom of choice is sacrosanct, that nobody is ever told to do anything on the earth, be any type of character, be any particular sex, be born into any country without their acquiescence and understanding this is for my greater good. Often, we are told through my hypnotized clients that even though they're going through a stressful time, and that's why they came into my office to try and understand it, when they get into the superconscious state, they will often say, don't worry about the problem I came here for. I now realize and understand why that back pain, that problem with my something or another is there. It's playing a part and it's holding me back at this time because I need to learn something. I'll give you an example. About a year ago, I had a man about my age, 60, and he was walking with a walking stick. Very agile mind, extremely intelligent man, a lot of fun to joke with. I try to make the sessions funny if I can, where it's appropriate. And he had a wonderful quick sense of humour, the complete opposite of his legs. I just almost got you. I had one flight of steps in George's place and he had real trouble getting up there. Under hypnosis, sorry, in the preamble to our first session, he had told me how he was always fascinated in the Second World War, and in particular, the Spitfires of the Battle of Britain. So, of course, I'm hearing potential conscious interference here, so I've got to be very careful. He's already leading into a particular type. So you've got to be as clinical as you possibly can and try and trip up at certain pace just to make sure that what he experiences should he go there is, in fact, probably real. I hypnotized him. And he said, I have a deep sense of guilt, like something is incomplete and I've failed and something, somehow these legs have something associated with that. I've really let something down, somebody down. So, under hypnosis, go back to the source of your guilt, the source of this fascination with you're not good enough, and that you deserve to be punished. And he went, sure enough, back to an airfield in Great Britain during the Second World War, during the Battle of Britain. And he was quite disappointed when I asked him, look down on your feet, describe what you see, go start to build up the scenario. You could hear that he was quite disappointed to realize, I'm not a pilot. That's when I realized that these are the sorts of little giveaways where, you know, the ego wanted to be a pilot. But he was quite disappointed to say, I'm a commander here. Oh, I don't fly. So you could hear that his soul was kicking in and saying, you're involved with the war, and you certainly are involved with the Spitfires, but you're not a pilot yourself. What he was a senior officer, and his particular role was logistics. He was able to work out flight patterns and things and train the young guys, all the rest of it, to attacks and formations that worked and didn't work. And he had a great love for the boys, as he called them. And they clearly loved him. He arrived back at the scene that day. A couple of the propellers were going because they kept the couple apparently always turning over in case there was some rogue plane that came in from somewhere or something like that. And you could see and hear his body language, even though he was deeply hypnotized, his body language was completely in admiration and love for these brave lads. And he recalled, I said, let's go to the scene where we came into this for. You've come from a sense of guilt. Let's go to where the subconscious or your guides know that this or suspect that this has begun. And the next thing he sees, that one evening, and every time some new pilots would be coming in, they would do bonding sessions. And amongst the bonding sessions, he would always instill with the guys that should the Germans come across, because remember the Battle of Britain was a preemptive to the invasion of England by the Germans. So they were expecting to see landing craft coming across from Dover and the White Cliffs and etc. any day. So of course they were frightened. And what's going to happen to their families and all the rest. So they had made a pact that should the Germans arrive en masse, we are a squadron that sticks together and we will look after each other and we leave no man behind. Okay? The next thing that happened in this tale was that he was unexpectedly blown to pieces. Some sort of a raid and a bomb hit right next to him and he literally could see his body in pieces. But being an old soul, he quickly understood, oh, time to go. If you'd seen his, if you'd seen the earlier part of his life, I'm just telling you a little bit, but his childhood, it had been all been prepped for him being a senior officer as an old soul during this time of war, because he had a great rapport with the lads and a lot of respect from the other officers. He was a good man to be in charge at that time. A lot of innate wisdom. And the men were loyal to him because they knew that he cared. It wasn't just intellectual, but he had a real heart. Anyway, so he went back to the light, and having done his service. When he comes back to my office, I said to him, well, okay, you haven't finished. Go back to the site and say, ask your guides to bring to your attention the missing link here. There's something missing here. And it came intuitively. The guide sometimes put a little egg in my head. Ask, are there any men left behind? And he asked that. And sure enough, there were three spirits that were still attached to the airfield. And they were still in uniform. They were Spitfire pilots. They had also been blown up in that or another attack. Because they were young souls, they didn't know about going back to the light. And their sense of duty to the squad was so great that even though they felt like they should go somewhere, they didn't know where, and they felt that their loyalty, until dismissed, was to stay there. Time in the spirit world passes very quickly, very slowly in comparison to the quickness on the earth. Time doesn't really exist, but... So I prompted him and said, you better relieve these men. Take their salute and say, boys, you want to go home? Yes, sir. So share a cognac together and, honour the boys that have died and all your loved ones. And take the salute, relieve them, share a cognac, and then say, would you like to go home? Then call your loved ones. And the next thing is in my chair, oh, look at that. And he says, what are you seeing? He says, I'm seeing all these streaks of light coming down from above, coming and getting them and escorting them home. And it was absolutely beautiful minute. I think I was crying too, because the way he was crying, it was just very, very touching. I think I might have had something to do with the Second World War too. Why I'm telling you this story is I'm trying to help us to understand that there is a legacy that carries forward from lifetime to lifetime. If you saw some of the things that I see, you'll see that there is a storybook. And just like a good Dickens book, it starts and goes into all sorts of complexities and richness and develops into a story that is full of adventure. Now, we have collectively a thing called the Akashic Records. The Akashic Records, I think, is a Sanskrit or Pali word which was pinched by... the sleeping prophet, what was his name? Thank you, Edgar Cayce. And Edgar Cayce coined the idea of the Akashic Records, being that every human being, collectively and nationally, etc., had books, we'll call them books, that have all the records of everything that you and I have ever done. Our dreams, our successes, our failures, etc. What we do with past life regression and life between life is we gain access to those books. We open them. We open the ones that are appropriate for the client to see at that time. On that day, it was appropriate for my client to go back to the Second World War. And once he saw that those men are now gone back to the light, he said, I've got it. My guilt comes from that I didn't fulfill my promise. We left men behind, and even though I don't need any guilt on this, I didn't do this out of spite. There was no malice of any form, but there was a sense that it was incomplete. Now that the lads have gone home, I can forgive myself. We did a little ritual of self-forgiveness through sacred fire, and he was cleansed. Then I said, what about the legs? Has that worked on the legs? Is that going to bring the strength of your legs back? And I asked him to have a conversation with his guides, and they said, no, there's something else. I said, do you want to solve that in the next session? And he talked to his guides, and he said, no, actually leave it. That was your original reason for coming to see me. You sure you're telling me we don't want to pursue that any further? And he said, yeah, I know where it's coming from. You know, some of my old lives I've been pretty arrogant. And the legs really hold me back. And if I got my full leg usage back, I might become a little bit arrogant again, and I really don't want to do that again. So I accept this as good karma. And besides, I'm doing a lot of reading and I'm doing a lot of studying because I'm not playing out there, you know, and I'm learning a lot of things. So it's a win-win. So I share this one story for you just to give you an example of how a past life regression may go, right? And from that, then to the life between lives. Now, the last bit of the life between life is that before we prepare to rebirth then, we have things that we can do back in the spirit world, which again I won't go into any detail here and now, but some of them are just fantastic. Some of the concerts we all go to in the spirit world are absolutely amazing. They are truly wondrous experiences of sound and light. And of course then we have the time when it's time to go back to our soul group, and that's always a beautiful experience with a real sense of going home to true love, no judgment, and complete acceptance and understanding from your loved ones. After a while, it's time to reincarnate. That's different for everybody, depending on what the sort of cycle that you've chosen to be on. When that time comes, your guides or the masters will speak to you directly. Come and see us. You'll go to the masters, they will debrief you, and you'll go into considerable detail about where you're at, if you're going through a series of lives, how that last life fulfilled or didn't fulfill the quotient that was necessary. But it's always done with help and a sense of encouragement and no judgment whatsoever. Then we then prepare for our next life. If we're in a circumstance where we're not in a series of lives where the next life is more or less a given, then you'll hear my clients speak about being presented with two or three bodies. Get this, two or three bodies that they can choose to come into, given the type of lesson that they've discussed with their master they need to be on right now. The central theme is always, we're always becoming more. We're always becoming more. There's always more in the universe to learn. There are many other dimensions and planes than just planet Earth. And this one is considered to be one of the schools of hard knocks. All of us who are in this room choose to come here, and we all know how dense and slow and stripping of dignity this place can be at times. We insult each other, we hurt each other, we lie to each other, we cheat each other. It's not just humans, incidentally. Notice that animals are violent too. Even insects are. It's something about this dimension, the density of this dimension, makes us feel cut off, and we tend to strike out. Don't worry about it. We're all a part of it. It's going about to change into a much better thing. But we're at the tail end of those lessons. We're about to go into another state of consciousness, and in preparation for that, these bodies are presented to you for the lesson that you need to experience. I've had people say to me, can you tell me about the three bodies that you're seeing are being offered to you? What are the pros and cons of each? I won't go into that right now because time doesn't permit, but they will actually tell me why that body was offered to me, the sort of ego that body is going to have. Because there's an ego mind, which comes from the genetics within the body, the DNA within the body, as well as the soul's innate elevation, progress. Just like you can give a Stradivarius to a 10-year-old who's learning the violin and he'll still make it screech. Or you can give a $10 violin to a master violinist and he'll still make it sound beautiful. Put the two together and you've got a great violinist with a great violin, and you'll hear sounds that are rare. So too it is with the soul. When a soul has a really, really good body, then amazing things can happen. I'm getting told through hundreds of clients that we're about to go through a transitional period, and that it's going to be good news. That many of us, myself, I am very aware of the density of my body at the moment. I'm over it. I love it, But as I was saying to Ian before, just like the old bike that was worn out and tired, or my old car, I might like it, but if it's clunking and the gears won't change and it's using 5 litres of petrol to get me up the road, much as I've loved it and it served me well, I'm really waiting for the new car to come along and enjoy the comforts of the better car. And when the old car, I'll wave it and say, goodbye, you've served me well, but I need to move on. That's the way I feel about these changes. I'm being told by guides of most of my clients to pass on to those that will listen, and again, I'm not trying to sell, just put it to your feet and consider it, that the worst thing we can do right now is try and anticipate too much of what the change is going to be. I'm told to recommend that we just trust in our own goodness, our own inward desire for win-win scenarios, that we would that this planet were better managed, that distribution of the supply of food, electricity, money, water, anything was fairer, that greed wasn't rampant, and all those 7 deadly sins weren't so extremely rampant at this time. Where I'm told that the change will happen relatively quickly, and that when it happens, it would be advisable for us to have a little bit of food in the house. No panic, we're not talking about years or months. A little bit of extra cash, but when you go through this time, you'll be in such a lovely state yourself that you'll just intuitively and increasingly know what to do next. During the sleep patterns at the moment, we are being trained and prepared for a change in frequency that will happen rapidly. You'll note that in one of the paragraphs I say, many of my clients walk in and say to me, I'm just so over the injustice in this planet, I'm detaching. Right? I can't watch the news anymore. And I'm moving to the hills. Or I'm going to go on a collective farm. George, of course, is organising one, so if that feels attractive to you, talk to George. And we have many light workers, such as Judy Ann and Paul and George and Ian, and I'm sure many of you in here are healers, or at least in some way are working to amortise the cruelties of this earth in your own little way, whether it be hug your kids or do something in your community whereby we try just to bring our little microcosm, what the things that we affect, into love and generosity and forgiveness. One of the most important things for all of us right now is to forgive ourselves for any of our past mistakes. That is one thing that I strongly recommend everybody do, and you'll see that there's a little exercise, the aura awareness that I put here, and that will help you dramatically to transform from being an ego mind full of the intellectual questions to the soul mind that is really effortless and eternal. The whole soul mind, when I'm speaking to the superconscious of clients, you'll hear, as I said, in a minute we'll play some of these, and you'll hear the transformation within a matter of 10 minutes of my client going from, there's still some ego there, to slowly but surely becoming quite authoritative about what she is and what she isn't. And that's part of true of all of us. It doesn't matter whether you're a young soul or a master. We all come from the same source. Okay. We all come from the same source to which we will return. The path to return is so long that to try and anticipate too much of it is just live in the now, be in the now, appreciate the people around you, and most importantly, work on forgiving yourself for any things that your ego has said you haven't done well enough, or in the cases I deal with, we've carried forward from other lives. And just be at peace with the fact that no soul is lost. Every soul, every human being, every animal has a soul. It goes back into the spirit world, recycle. Nothing is ever lost. We don't have to worry or panic about anything. Of course, we'd like to see this beautiful planet that we all love go through this transition as effortlessly as possible. But there are dark forces working here too. We represent the light workers. If you would that everybody had a fair share of everything and that we could all walk around just hugging one another, rest in yourself, because you're one of us. Okay? So, the masters will therefore give you a sense of where you are in this big scheme, and then help you to come back into the earth. But at all times, you are given the choice of what body you will come into and why. You are a divine spark, and the absolute quintessential full stop essence of all of us is a divine spark. And even the masters bow to the young souls. I had a librarian once tell me how she's in between lives, she's a librarian helping younger souls to review their lives, to learn lessons that will help them in their next incarnation. And I asked, I said, do you ever get stumped with complex circumstances that, you know, she's quite learned, she's a specialist in this area, but is there any times when you get stumped yourself and the younger guide asks you questions that you don't know the answer to? Yes, it happens. Can you go to a moment like that and relive it for me? She says, yes, I had one recently where a girl had suicided in her previous lifetime, and I worked out some scenarios, cause and effect. It's all about cause and effect. But she was asking me some questions that I wasn't satisfied with my answers, so I called that master. And as she, in her hypnosis, saw the master approaching, she bowed. I instinctively bowed too. And I said, why do you bow to the master? Is it demanded? I knew very well that was, but I wanted to just to see. And she said, oh no, she was, you know, defending the master. Of course, no, they're far too beautiful for that. It's just that they emanate such wisdom, such love, that when you're in their presence, you just are thankful you're in their presence. There's so much beauty emanating from them. That you're in their space is just, oh, thank you. You know, just, and the truth that comes through. And even he asked the young student, before he entered into her Akashic book, do I have permission to enter into your personal data? Sacrosanct. And I said, why would he ask? He said, because she doesn't know it yet. But she's the same spark as he was. He's been around for billions of years and she's young. But he knows that she is his sister. At the truest fundamental quintessential level, I'm bowing to the one. All right? I said, yeah, that's what I'd want a master to do. It sounded right to me. And so, he was able to extrapolate cause and effects far wider to this person. He could see great distances and evolutionary choices that she's probably going to make given this, given that, and all the rest of it. So that's the basics of what I do, what the Newton Institute does, and all the rest of it. Now, the first part of the talk, we'll do this thing on a couple of in the womb experiences. You'll hear the first one is a very, very short one, a very typical type of in the womb discussion where I ask her about her mother and about how she feels in the womb. It's only a short one. Could you play that for us, please, Paul?
Feelings of your mother, the heartbeat. The feelings of being restricted in your mother's womb again inside your mother's tummy. But also the feelings and emotions that accompany being here now. You're about to take off on a mission on earth. As soon as you have felt enough contact to speak to me about it, I'd like you just to find the voice box and tell me how you're feeling inside your mother's womb.
There's a feeling of anticipation and excitement.
Mm-hmm. Why would that be?
Just a feeling of eagerness to get out there and get on with the job.
Well, if you're coming on and needing an eagerness to get on with the job, I presume that you've got some task that is uppermost in your thoughts. Can you just catch up with what that feeling is, what that sense is? Let it just come to you. What do you feel that you want to get on with?
Just the learning, the experiencing. Nothing specific.
Good. I'd like you just to start to feel the presence of your mother. You and she, for all intents and purposes at this time, are at one. You can sense her very clearly. Being very honest, how do you feel that your mother is feeling about your presence?
She's excited, but there's a sense of physically she's over it.
Well, I think you probably understand most bodies by the time they've got the 8th or 9th month is well and truly weary. Mm. And besides, she wants to meet you. But as you just become aware of that feeling, as a general sense, do you feel that you're wanted?
Yes.
You can understand it's important.
Mm-hmm.
So I'd like that just to, that feeling or sense of being able to recognize, yes, you're wanted. Just to pass through all of your subconscious blocks. Just feel it being reminded to your subconscious, I'm wanted, I'm loved.
Mm.
It's that tiny one.
What about the feeling of the space in there? Is it cramped? Are your arms and legs okay?
It's comfortable.
Everything's comfortable. Good. And I'm just going to ask you, how do you feel at any time that you can hear the voices of others that are around you, perhaps your father or other ones that come and talk? Maybe sometimes you can actually feel that people are asking about you, how she's carrying, is she happy, is she having any difficulties? Can you feel or sense any other voices?
Mm-hmm.
Any of them that you know to be potentially there?
No. There's a female voice.
Mm-hmm. I'd like you just to turn on your all knowing mind. And who do you believe that was?
My grandma.
And grandma. Nice. Just hear the voice again. This is your grandma. That's the voice of your grandma. You know it very clearly. She's excited for you and for your mom. Nice. Love is a good thing.
Love is a good thing. We're just having a little bit of chat, so you just pop that up, and I think it just should have no name when you get it in the second one, if you can prepare that second one. Now, as you heard, that was a fairly typical sort of in the womb experience, where she's able to, she went later into her particular life's mission. She said she wants to get on with her mission. I didn't play it because it's really quite personal for her, but she did let me play that part for us. And but of course, as I said before, there are many light workers and a lot of old souls on the earth at the moment. You'll hear from other people doing this sort of work, which is that we've attracted an inordinate amount of old souls to the earth at the moment. Some of the earth changes that are happening, which this next person will sort of allude to a little bit, I'm being told, and my colleagues are being told, that the changes on the about to happen on the earth are not like other experiences. I've been back to many previous civilizations millions of years ago. We've had times of great peace on the earth before and far more advanced technology than we've got now.
But the reasons why even the masters are really excited about the change that we're all on the earth to participate in is because we're about to try an experiment that's never been done before. Sorry. We're about to enter into a time when the earth will, as one master put it to me, we're going to experiment with marrying the consciousness of the earth, Gaia. I mean, a lot of us call it her Gaia, but whatever you consider the name of the central soul of this planet to be, she's ready for initiation. She's ready to move forward. She's given a lot of sacrifice for a lot of stupid human beings. And a lot of us are sorry about that. We don't need to apologize, but we need to get on with it. And a lot of us are going to enter into a marriage in this new time. And this has not been done quite in this way before. There have been many evolutionary jumps, but this is going to be an experimentation that only a few are allowed to participate in. And from what I'm told, there is quite a bank up of souls that say, if you opt out, they will happily take your place. So even though we're going through extremely difficult moments right now, we see the winding down of logic of any form on this planet. Greed is just becoming rampant. And the poorer and poorer distribution of resources. Try to remain within yourself, centralized, and trust in the good that's going to emanate. If you're given a specific task to help something, to get involved, by all means, and get involved in your community, your family, whatever it is. But spend plenty of time meditating, plenty of time praying, and don't worry about what's happening out there. This cannot be fixed. It needs to break down first. It's beyond repair. But the good news is, if you're attracted to this type of talk, you're probably one of us. And I emphasize that storing years of food, there's no point. If you are in a body that you've selected with your masters, that you're supposed to make it through the times of transition, then you're going to make it through. Because they will walk you through any dangers and lead you to the food and the resources that you need. It's already planned, it's already worked out. Great minds better than ours are in charge of this. We don't have to worry. We're the foot soldiers down here. Let the generals, and they're not American generals that will give you something and sell you off with a gun. These are the good guys. They're great and wonderful beings. And they will look after us. Alternatively, even if you are a light worker, but you're not supposed to make it through the transitional times. It doesn't matter how much food you store away or how far away from the chaos you go, you're not going to make it. It's predetermined by you and your guides. As I say in the letter, you can come back in another vessel. Don't worry about it. Right? Just start to recognize that all of us are making that transition now from believing that I'm a human being with a soul to starting to begin to actually feel I am without end. And that is going to elevate that nowness, that wonder that I am and always will be fine. That the body may perish, as I have in many, many, done with hundreds of clients. Before their death, they're often worried about dying. Once they leave the body, the inevitable thing is, oh my God, why did I cling on to that body? It was so broken, so old. And being out of that body is, back into the spirit. How seriously we take it when we're in the body. So try and look for the fact that whatever your mission is, you don't have to search too hard. You're innately prepared for it. And you're being prepared during your sleep patterns. Some of us will find our sleep patterns are being broken. We have little periods of time when we can't sleep very well. There are nights that are being, frequencies are being put through your spine, through your neurological networks, and in preparation for the flip. Okay? So, in this next talk, we'll hear... No? keep on. Okay, so razzle dazzle them. It won't play. Okay. Play amongst yourselves for a minute.
Okay, so we've got it going. Now this is it's a longer one. I apologise for that, but I've tried to edit it as much as I can. But I want to remain loyal to the fact that she's given me permission to use this.
Secondly, there's a heck of a lot of information in here, and whilst I know it's a little tedious to listen to audio, same as me, but if you actually listen, you will hear the voice of a truly old soul. I felt extremely guilty taking money from this woman because I felt I learned a lot more from her than she learned from me. She's a suburban housewife, but she was recognizing that she was being awakened by coming and doing these sessions into another aspect of herself that I've been alluding to, this superconscious state that is beginning to emanate in so many of us. She's awakened a little earlier than some of us, and she is getting on with her job right now. And you'll hear that she comes from, she was born to a mother in the East, I think Poland or Ukraine, that part there. She's fairly elderly, so the mother would have come, she was actually living in that country before she came to Australia. You'll hear a strong accent, you'll need to listen carefully. And you'll hear that the mother doesn't want this child. As opposed to the first one where we heard, my mother loves me, I'm looking forward to this, you'll hear this person describing a scared and jealous mother. But that preparation is actually gearing her up for and bolstering her courage and strength in so many ways. Can you play that one for me, please? And then we'll take a break.
Good. Let's start off with, how does your mother feel about you? How do you feel that your mother feels about being pregnant to you?
She's not happy at all. She doesn't want another child.
Does not want another child.
Another child, and especially she doesn't want a girl. She's quite particular about that.
Using your wisdom of all your knowledge now, why is it that you sense that she doesn't want a girl in particular?
It's because she sees her life as a very unfortunate one, and she thinks that I will have also an unfortunate life. And she somehow doesn't want to see or feel another woman around her. It's like she feels it's going to be a competition to her in some ways.
Now, using the wisdom of hindsight and higher perspective, the deeper mind that's aware of all of this, do you feel that you can start to lessen that feeling of not being wanted now? Can you start to understand her motives are somewhat simple, shall we say, unsophisticated, uneducated, those types of things? Can you see that in her own fear, her own dread is actually creating problems that are not necessarily there? But can you understand how it is that such a
a woman at that time in those circumstances has this concern?
Yes. She cannot cope with her life. So that would be for her another burden.
Yes. Yes, she's having difficulty with her life. Can that help you to feel a sense of understanding and tolerance towards her, intolerance towards you?
Yes, but also she is intelligent enough to understand that I am not in any fault of that.
Mm. And yet she still doesn't want to see that, does she?
Exactly. Mm. She is in denial. Her life is one big denial. She lives by denial and lies.
And you know this already?
Yes.
I want you now just to register that, and I want you just to, as best as you can, see if you're aware of the fact that you're coming into a mother that has all these negative traits running through her. And that even as an unborn child, you're already registering these things. But I want you also to use that bigger picture knowledge, the soulful knowledge, and see if you can just begin to drop as much of the anxiety that you can about this birth. I would like you to find a safe and sensible way just to neutralize as much of that ill feeling as possible. Are you prepared to do that?
Yes.
And just feel yourself using your own inner wisdom. And that perhaps you're coming to this lifetime, perhaps, you're coming as much to teach her as to learn from these experiences. For some reason or another, there's something in this for you, as there is something in it for her. When you feel that you've got a more comfortable state, say, really.
Yes.
Good. Now I want you to go to the next stage, and as you perceive it, I want you to feel yourself when you first come into, as a pure consciousness, into the fetus, the very first occasion. Let your mind just dissolve now and move to the time when you're coming into the body that is going to be Ursula the very first time. Feel your mind expanding, letting go. And when you've got that, just say ready.
Ready.
I want now for you to look and sense the body that you're coming into and tell me about this body. And especially I want you to feel the brain and the way that you've come into the body. Let's start with the way you enter the body. As you prepare to come into little Ursula for the first time, tell me what your feelings are about this lifetime you're about to enter.
There are two predominant emotions. One is excitement, and the second one would be facing very big adversities. And it's like you feel that you want to do something, but you know it's going to cost you high. You want this, but on the other hand, you know that it is going to be traumatic experience. So two really conflict emotions.
As you actually enter, I want you to go into fine detail now and tell me about how you enter the body, where you actually enter with your mind, your consciousness, where you enter the body for the very, very first time when you come into it.
It's like I am sliding in. Into a head, and from that point just going down. It's from top of the head going down. It's like going from the top to bottom and occupying the parts of the body, which was a phantom body.
What do you mean a phantom body? Why is it a phantom body?
Because it didn't have a soul in it.
Oh, yes, of course. Yes, I'm sorry. Of course. Until you enter it, it doesn't have a soul. That's right. As you enter into the body, you start to explore the network of the brain and the neurons to the various arms and legs and feelings. As you explore it, what do you register about the body that you're coming into?
I feel that it's a female body. I feel that it's a very beautiful body, a very, very... how to describe it? It is a very particularly delicate and beautiful and pristine.
You think that about all bodies you occupy? You're saying this particular one?
I would say this particular one.
It's pristine.
It's pristine. It's something about this body. This body is just has something which together with the soul makes that combination of something special. Energy, yes, that's it. It's like when people will look at this body from the very moment the body will be born, people will be amazed about the beauty of it and joyful to be in a body like this.
When you come into the body, you say you slide in. I want you to actually go to the actual detail of when you come to the body. What do you mean you slide in? Do you literally come in through the crown chakra, through the third eye? Where do you come in?
You are coming through the crown chakra. The energy of the crown chakra is being opened and the energy is going in. The very, very condensed particles of energy concentration are being implanted, slided in through the head chakra.
So the particles that are sliding in are your soul?
Only a particle of this, yes. But very highly condensed.
Highly condensed particles?
Yes.
Would there be one or two of those? Hundreds, thousands, millions?
Oh, thousands, billions, billions.
Billions of these particles?
Yes, yes. The molecules are so small and so condensed that even atom seems to be big with them. There is no word in human vocabulary for it. Particle is the closest.
Thank you. Good. So, and what about the brain? So you're happy with the brain and the neural network? You're happy that the body is not going to be just a good-looking one to be admired? You're also satisfied that you've chosen a good vessel in the sense of the brain?
The body is very strong one. The body is particularly equipped. I must say equipped, yes, that's the right word. The body is particularly equipped in the way of immunity and endurance as it will survive quite unpleasant adversities, which people call illnesses or some other happenings, that immunity is particularly designed to withstand things which are harmful. Because the soul knows that the body is going to be in very threatening circumstances for the physical health, from the energetical point of view, being surrounded by highly toxic energy fields with those around, which I must say will be my mother. So that design is made in particular way, so this body is immune to high degree to that. Otherwise it will be otherwise it would be, in human words, called very sick or not able to cope. So that is a high level of energy, vibrational field, I put it this way, within the cellular level of energy levels, that they will protect that body from that energies. And that is going to be for the life. It's even though those energies will be not present, that is designed for the life for this body.
Yeah. And now that we've seen all that, once again, I want you just to feel and sense the emotions of the mother, as unpleasant as they are, and realizing, of course, that you're going through those toxic circumstances in this lifetime. Do you feel that you're going to learn something important from having such a toxic mother?
Definitely, yes.
What would you be learning from your mother?
I am going to learn about the highest possible level of human mind, low level of the human mind distortion, which is some call it an illness or disorder, but in the reality it is not. It is only a chosen for that particular life by that soul and person, a chosen way to be, put it this way, that is not an illness as such. It is a high level distortion caused by high egoic mind.
Is the egoic mind part of the soul or part of the brain that your mother has occupied?
It is a difficult question, as definitely for the body. As for the soul, I am not fully aware of that, how much of the quality of that soul has that issue with it, or learning from it, or I am not familiar. I do only understand that it must be a connection between that mind and that soul in some ways, which is not being understood by me, as it is not my level. It is a level when soul is learning the basics.
So you've chosen to be this low-level soul's egoic mind's learning curve. For what purpose? How are you going to benefit from being born into such a soul struggling with this egoic mind?
It is going to fulfill a few major purposes. The number one is the highest possible strengthening for the soul, being exposed to the high level of adversity, that is to strengthen the qualities of the soul, being exposed to that. The secondary would be for the high purpose of teaching, as to understand the low-level mind function, you must be exposed to it to the closest possible degree and to the closest possible way being affected to understand the anatomy and physiology of it. And I am going to teach this. That's...
So you can effectively learn yourself by being very, very close, very affected by this. So you will learn some deep issues and understandings about such a conflicted mind. And you, on the other hand, will help her to experience something of higher consciousness. Is that something along that line?
That is very correct. Mm.
Is there anything else about being in the womb that you feel is interesting or fascinating that you wish to share, or are you prepared to move along now?
I would like to stress one thing, which is not much science directed on it, is that the medical world is in denial and doesn't want to spend more time and effort on the effects of the emotional state of the mother for the unborn child. This is the major cause of a lot of illnesses, which are very often manifesting with the little babies. All of those are very much connected with the emotional state of a woman. being pregnant, and that is being not being addressed practically at all. And that needs to be focused on the state a pregnant woman is, emotional state she is in.
Okay, we'll take a break in a minute. I just want to touch on a couple of things that were of interest. And one is, of course, that the soul doesn't always come in through the third eye or in through the crown. Different levels of souls come in at different points of the body. Usually the higher evolved souls come in through the crown. And it was described to me once that if you're going to live a life where you're going to be very involved in spiritual work, you'll even spin as you come in through the crown chakra, that you're taught different methods of coming into the body by the masters, learning, I suppose, like anyone becomes a master at anything, that you learn progressively finer and finer degrees of doing things. The second thing is that you, as I said, I know this particular client is one of four or five of the oldest souls that I've ever had the pleasure to work with. You've only heard a little bit of it. We did quite a lot of sessions. And she was an extremely learned being on the planet, and she's getting on with some wonderful things now. You'll notice that she actually said that the adversity strengthens her soul. I'd like to underline that, because what I'm getting from not only that statement but from most of my clients is, when I ask them, why have you gone through this pain that you're going through in the relationships, or why have you chosen a body that's having so many lousy things happen, blah 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 blah, when they're in the higher conscious state, they'll inevitably say, it's worth the lessons that I'm paying, because the more I experience negativity, the more learned my soul becomes. I cannot experience this sort of negativity in the spirit world. It doesn't exist. So whilst I'm on the earth, I might as well get on with it. It's tough when I'm down here, but it is a roller coaster ride. You are guaranteed to get off. Okay? So no matter how scared you are when you're upside down and you regret getting on the roller coaster ride, okay, and you know, stuff you got, and I don't believe any of this, and the whole place is insane, which of course it is, you are guaranteed to get off. So this is the thing, the central thing that I get from my client. You've chosen a hard life. Are you you're regretting having chosen this hard life? You're in relationship problems, or you're poor, or this and the other, or this guy with the walk. And inevitably, when you get to the higher consciousness, they'll say, my ego doesn't like it, but it's good for me. That's talking about the soul. And the second thing that she touched upon was low-level souls. You need to get close to the low-level souls as possible. This particular soul is all but a master. And one of the things that masters must learn is to remain detached from things that we care about. If you have something that you love, but it chooses to play with matches, after a certain amount of indoctrination about how matches are dangerous, it's best that they do it whilst you're watching than when you're out and then they finally find the matches and burn your house down. There are certain proclivities that every soul must go through before we become masters ourselves. And one of the harder things for masters to learn to do is to allow the wards underneath them, who are younger souls, who they love completely, and watch them go into experiences that they know is going to be a train wreck. But they must allow freedom of choice to take place. And that's one. And so by being close to her mother, and of course she didn't know that when she was a child, she went through some horrendous experiences, this woman. Really, the mother was insane. And she really treated this poor girl horribly. The fact that she's such a loving and wonderful and giving person today is really a testament to the strength of the soul in this particular ego. So I'll just leave that with you, that what we're suggesting, therefore, is that you've chosen the circumstances you're in. So be at peace with whatever's happening in your life. as I've suggested before, what's happening on the earth is going to be a good thing. That's what I'm getting. Even though temporarily it looks like the proverbial is hitting the walls. It's going to change for the better. And the best way that we can facilitate that is by remaining in the now, and we'll do that exercise of the aura, how we can actually train ourselves to become more aloof and rise above the density of the cells of this body. Love your body, but learn. We can also learn how to start to use the ego mind and start to train it to listen to and work to the soul mind as it becomes more active in these times. Okay, break now. We'll start again in a little while, and we'll start on earth changes.